Ni le bien qu'on m'a fait, ni le mal, tout ça m'est bien égal. Non, rien de rien, non, je ne regrette.
This week on The Shtick we have with us as our very special guest, a legend in her own lifetime, a Melbourne icon, an artistic wizard, Mirka Mora. I just wanted to ask Mirka, what's your shtick?
Well, my chick, my chick is, shtick. My stick, I can't say, is painting, of course, and all the art form, music, writing, dancing, but mostly I'm a painter, therefore I paint every day. First thing I do in the morning, and I stop at 12 o'clock, and then the world is my oyster. I can do what I want, even if I'm very tired. Because painting is very, very tired. Very euphoric, but very tiring.
We're sitting here in Mirka's kitchen, which is part of her residence and studio. I just wanted to ask you, Mirka, is this part of your lifestyle? Is this the bohemian central that you display in your art?
Thank you very much for admiring my inferno. But it's really, it's a kind of clutter. Some people think it is clutter. Actually, I wrote a book called Love and Clutter. But I think you have to have clutter because every object is a souvenir, a remnant of a moment, and we have so many moments in our lives that are neglected. I'm always for finding the moments I don't remember, and this is where I'm very lucky to be a painter, because my work sometimes surprises me and reminds me of people or places or emotions. So clutter is very important to me.
I just wanted to talk to you about your hands. There was an article in this week's Age about hands, and you made the fabulous quote about keeping the wonder that keeps the imagination going. You have such delicate, beautiful hands of a child. Amazing.
Well, I am a woman, and I should have had hands of a woman. I think it's very beautiful to have the hands of a woman, but my hands are the same one as I have when I was 12. Actually, my father gave me a silver cymbal when I was little to learn to sew, and it still fits my finger. So it's very strange to have the hands of a child, but I'm extremely lucky because it means that I'm my unconscious and my conscious. And you can see that I love Freud, but I read Jung. It means that I'm still a child in this very difficult, complicated world. And I think a lot of painters are like that. They keep their childishness. Because if you are childish, you can face the world.
I just wanted to know a little bit about guilt this week, because that's our topic. And I know as a bohemian, and I'm one of those as well, where is your guilt?
It's a word I do not accept. You should never be guilty, because if you do a mistake, I call a mistake a learning. You're learning something, and it's good for you to do mistakes. But I never feel guilt. I'm like Edith Piaf. Non, je ne regrette rien.
Speaking about Edith Piaf, I just wanted to ask you, and I'm actually sitting currently in the chair that he used to occupy whenever he came to Melbourne, very close friends of Mirka. I just wanted to ask you about the recently departed giant of mime, Marcel Marceau.
Yes, Marcel Marceau was a great friend of the Mora family. He He was my teacher when I was 17. I decided to go to theater school, but I saw an article in a French newspaper about the group of people who constructed that school, and it was called L'éducation par le jeu et l'art dramatique, and in it were the most famous names that I could remember, like Jean-Louis Barrault, Marcel Marceau, of course, Jean-Marie Conti, who had flown with Saint-Exupéry in a little aeroplane, and Marie-Hélène Dasté, who was an extraordinary teacher. She never wore underpants, and she would put her leg on a chair, and all the boys and girls could see what we could see. She was sensational.
They were the eccentric rat pack.
Voilà.
Yes.
But they were very learned.
Highly talented,
and all struggling, because as you know, all forms of arts are always still difficult to survive with.
This is such a beautiful studio.
Thank you.
I really am entranced by the clutter and the eclecticness of it all. I'm lost for words.
I'm not a maker of words, I'm a maker of images.
Well, Mirka, I have been greatly honoured to have you on the Shtick this week, and we hope to come back again, because I'm having such a great time here. We've just run out of time, and be well, and may you keep painting until you're 120 at least.
Thank you very much for interviewing me. And I'm going to watch number 31 all the time now. Thank you.
You're going to be a fan of the Shtick?
Oh, oui.
Fantastic.
If I can pronounce it, Shtick.
Shtick, it's a Yiddish word.
Ah, beautiful words.
You don't speak Yiddish?
Non, mais je comprends un peu. It's very beautiful, because my parents took me to a Yiddish play once in Paris, and I never forgot it. It was so special.
How old were you then?
Probably before the war, I would have been 9 years old or 10 years old. It always stayed in my mind because it was so homely and lively.
Did your parents speak any Yiddish?
They did speak Russian and Yiddish and French and what else?
Yeah.
That's it.
Yiddish seems to be a dying language now.
Oh, I hope not. I hope not.
But I still speak it, and we're encouraging people to speak Yiddish on the Shtick.
You know, when I first came to Melbourne, I used to go on the street on Sunday morning just to pick up Yiddish words so I wouldn't forget the language. Because in those, it doesn't happen so much now. It's too modern now at Clint Street. But in the 50s, even early 60s, you could see a group of very elderly Jewish men and women, but mostly men together talking. And I would walk between them like a little snake to catch a word, and it warmed my heart.